Hello, I'm Steve Damasco, Grand Master of Steve Damasco Shaolin Studios and International Ambassador to the Shaolin Temple in China. I was just at an event recently, which was really, really cool. My first Kung Fu instructor ever. I was a green belt when it started, when I started studying. I was still studying Kenpo at the time, but I started in Chinatown. With a master from China at that time. His name was Yan Li, and he's been, for many, many years now, he has been a Tai Chi, Qigong, and Chinese cultural instructor at Harvard University. And he asked me to speak. They had a roast for him, to honor him. It wasn't really roasting him. It was really to honor Grandmaster Yan Li at Harvard this past week. And there were over 200 people there, which was just incredible. You know, I've talked before about the Qigong and, you know, the people that got up and spoke, I had never met them before. There was about seven of us that got up and spoke on behalf of Yan at Harvard. And many of them were doctors from, you know, PhDs, I mean MDs. One was a doctor in neurology that graduated med school from Harvard University. And there were a very impressive number of people that were there talking about him. But so many of them had talked about how they had physical ailments. This one neurologist was talking about carpal tunnel and arthritis, and he said it was like he could barely touch anything, pick things up. He had no strength in his hand when he had met Yan, and Yan had worked on his hand a few times, and all the pain was gone. Now, you know, this is a neurologist, a medical doctor graduated from Harvard that said this. There was another guy that got up there, and he talked about a severe accident he had when he was 9 years old. That did something, mangled his face, you know, all kind of things on his face, and took his leg, and the way he described it, I can't even describe it, where the bone was coming out the side, it was really bad. They thought they would have to amputate the leg. Yan went up there with another master up at the hospital when he was nine, and they were actually boiling eggs. Children's Hospital, by the way. There's also this benefit, I neglected to say, was a benefit for the Children's Hospital. The proceeds went to that. So this kid talked about, oh, he's a guy now, he talked about how great the Children's Hospital was, and he wanted to become a pediatrician because of the experience he had there. It was very funny. It was the funniest thing he had said, because he said, I went to undergrad school for that and then wound up becoming a lawyer. Everybody pretty much laughed at that. But he talked about the boiling the eggs in the hospital room and putting this stuff on his face, and they were talking about how the scars had disappeared. It was amazing. And then Yan, for a long period of time, worked on his leg. And the guy's an athlete. I mean, by the way, I forgot to tell you, he was a gymnast. He was a gymnast that was qualifying for the Olympic team. And he thought his life was over. And Yan worked on his leg. And Master Yan worked on his leg and did the Qigong and healed his leg after these major operations that he had in his leg. So I just got to tell you that I was so impressed that Yan Li has affected so many people. And there's one other little thing I want to say about him is that, you know, when I started martial arts in 1971, towards the end of 71, and I was studying Kenpo, and like I said, I was around green belt level. I was trying to get into Chinese schools in Chinatown, and you know, nobody would take me. I mean, and that just didn't happen in 1971. It happened a lot throughout the years. I mean, I was in New York, I was in Connecticut. I really attempted to go into these kung fu schools in Chinatowns, and I was rejected. They didn't want to teach us. They didn't want to teach white people. And I mean, it's totally changed now. But Yan Li was the kind of guy, the kind of Chinese master that no matter what color you were, no matter what economic, socioeconomic background you came from, he didn't care. He didn't care what nationality you were. If you wanted to train and learn, then he would train you. And it was really funny because I talked about how I was pretty young when I went to see him, and I was a little cocky. I was a fighter. Forms were not really my thing. As a matter of fact, when I remember going up for my brown belt test, my green belt test, actually green belt, and they were laughing at me. My forms were so bad. And So I'm expecting to go in there and learn Tai, you know, this praying mantis system, which is what he was teaching at the time. And he said, no, we're not doing that yet. I said, okay, Shifu, what are we doing? He said, we're going to learn how to cook. And then, and I said, I didn't even know how to respond to that. So I had to spend an hour learning how to cook Chinese food. And then I said, great. And I said, okay, now do we have our lesson? No, we're going to learn how to do some Chinese medicine. And I said, wow. So that was another hour. And it was the last hour of the class that I actually got my lesson. So it was a 3-hour lesson, 3 hours of lessons to get a 1-hour private lesson with him. So I thought that was pretty comical. But the whole idea about what I'm talking about here is this Qigong is really real. It does really work, but you have to really know how to do this. I mean, a lot of people claim to be able to do Qigong, and I've seen it. And I don't want to say anything bad about anybody, but I've seen Qigong classes that are just, any exercise is good, but to claim that you're a Qigong master and you can do this Qigong is something that takes years and years and years and years. And it's usually passed down from one generation to another within the families. So not always, but a lot of times it is. So, I mean, I wouldn't take anybody's face value on the fact that somebody's a Qigong master, but I can tell you Yan Li is in Boston at Harvard University, and he's easy to track down if you ever have anything that you need somebody like him to work on. So anyway, that was a great event. The next thing I'd like to talk about is protection. You know, we talked about in the last show about handgun protection, and I'm going to do it a little bit different today. But before I get into that, I want to tell you about CPI. It was originally called Naked Dog Training, and it's there's still that Naked Dog Training website is still up, and you're going to see a video in a couple of minutes, a short film of how incredibly well these dogs are trained. And I remember being in a town meeting in my town where I live. There's been a lot of break-ins, and people were concerned about the robberies and people coming into the house. And I remember this guy got up. He had a long beard on. I don't know how old he was. Hard to tell. He was probably in his late 60s, and he got up and he stood up after everybody had talked, and he said, "You know, I have a dog that weighs 110 pounds." And I've been there for 25 years, and no one's ever come into my house. Well, that's great. And I got to tell you that, you know, there is a great deterrent if you have a dog that barks and sounds mean and sounds big. And that is a great line of defense, because the last thing somebody wants to mess with is one of those dogs. But after I show you this short video, I'm going to tell you what I've actually seen beyond that. So right now, Rick's going to show us the video, and then I'll tell you a little bit more about John and his operation.
The obedience is just remarkable. In Boston, I walk my dog, both German Shepherds, without a leash. From the moment I open my front door, I live in a loft in Boston, to getting in the elevator. There may or may not be other people in the elevator. Their manners are impeccable. Going outside, most of the time I don't need to have them specifically under command, but they're still, you know, completely obedient. So I walk a couple of blocks before I, to the area where I let them run. If people want to pet them, I let them. That's an individual choice, but I like my dogs to be social and friendly, and they are. And if my dogs are also trained to automatically stop at a curb. So if one dog is walking up ahead of us and one dog is near me, the dog will stop at the sidewalk, at the curb, and wait for us to catch up. And then we will cross. So it's little things like that that make they make dog walking a pleasure, but then again, of course, if I have the dogs under command, they, you know, won't be wandering everywhere. They'll be right with me if I want them to be. The level of obedience is such that I don't need to have them under command all the time. Is that they can just be free and be dogs, and you're not constantly telling the dog to do something. The dogs are walking down the street or the sidewalk or the fields, and they're just being dogs, unless you tell them to do something else. So under any circumstances, if I give a certain command, that both of my dogs will race to my side and protect me from anyone that's anywhere near me. They race to my side, show aggression, and stick to my side, literally pushing up against me, both dogs pushing up against me to prevent anyone from coming near me, and would protect me, would only attack somebody if they were to attack me, or if I was to give the command to attack. So it's really extraordinary, the sort of any time, anywhere, any place, any circumstance, that these dogs would do that. In the nicer weather in Boston, I take them to cafes. If I need to run in for a few minutes, I can tell the dog to lie down outside, and come back a few minutes later, the dog will not have moved. Or if I just want to have lunch at a cafe, the dog will just lie down next to me. I think for most people, it's almost hard to comprehend. I walk both of my German Shepherds off the leash in a city in rush hour traffic, and not be worried about them moving away from me or running out into traffic. It would be as if I had a leash on them, but I don't. If I am walking down the street with them and someone has another dog, many times you'll see the other dog with the other owner on a leash and pulling or growling or barking or trying to get at my dogs, and my dogs really don't even blink. They just stay with me. I can walk within 2 feet of a dog that's trying to desperately to get to them, and they'll just stay with me off the leash. So it's obedience beyond anything I've ever seen.
I gotta tell you that I'm so impressed with these dogs. I went up there to work with one of John's dogs, and by the way, like, he sells these dogs all over the world. I mean, people that have bought this dog, Steven Seagal has bought like 6 of these dogs. I don't know why he needs 6, but he's bought 6 of these dogs, and also he's bought them for his son. And I mean, the people buy these dogs from all over the world, from Italy, from Greece, from Middle East, everywhere. But I got to tell you, the first time I went up there to view these dogs, he brought out this dog, this shepherd called Elmo, which I thought was great. And I mean, this dog came running up to me. I called him by name. I said Elmo, and he's banging up against me and he's licking me. And I mean, you would have thought I owned that dog for like his life anyway. And then John told me what kind of commands to give the dog, and I was doing the same commands. I'd go with me and the dog would be with me, and I go, you know, and then all these other different commands. And then he had the trainer come out, because this was my first time working with a dog like that, so he didn't have me go through all the commands. But this was the most impressive thing. He had the trainer come out and went through the commands. And when you get trained to the level that Elmo's trained at, these two dogs that you just saw, he'll give a command, okay, where the perpetrator is there. And that dog, wherever that guy walks, the perpetrator walks, the dog will bark and growl, be angry and mean, but they will not attack the guy. The dog positions, wherever that guy moves, that dog leans up against the owner and positions himself, the dog positions themselves between the threat and the person. And that dog will not attack. I mean, the guy can bang that rubber hose, and he can yell at the dogs. He can get nothing. The dog will not move until that owner gives him the command. So then the trainer gives them the command, and they have this soft rubber hose, so the dog's on the arm, and the guy's whacking him, not hard, but just whacking him, just trying to get him to the height of insanity. The dog's drooling, biting this thing. I mean, it was like, this is the same dog that was just banging up against me and lapping me, and I'm going, this, it didn't even look like the same, obviously the same dog. I was just like, I couldn't believe it. I'm glad they did that first before I pet the dog, because I would have been scared of the dog. So then the dog is at the height of insanity, and they don't yell. They give the command. The trainer gave the command to stop in German. I forgot what that was. I should know that. But anyway, to stop in German, didn't yell, just set it. Within immediately from going from the point of sanity, trying to tear this guy's arm off, to the dog lays down like that. Can you imagine you in a situation and you're out of your mind, you're at the height of being upset, screaming, yelling, or whatever you're doing, fighting, and somebody just says to you, hey, you need to stop. And immediately you stop. I can't even imagine that, even myself with 45 years of martial art training. I mean, it was like, I was so impressed. I mean, these dogs are expensive. They go, the price of the dog, he gets these dogs from all over the world, but and very, very strong breeds. But the price of the dog is determined by how many years he trains the dog. Some dogs just train for obedience because that's all the owner wants. Other dogs are trained for obedience and for protection, which is what you saw. So I know the guy, John, personally. I've known him for a long period of time. I'm sure there's trainers that do what he does. I don't know. But I have never seen anything. There's one other film that I saw where this woman was on Fifth Avenue in New York City. She had a Great Dane. I mean, you know how big those dogs are. So she's walking the dog, and no leash. Walking the dog, she goes into a dress shop, tells the dog to sit, and other dogs are going by on their leashes, barking at this huge Great Dane. It's always the little dogs that bark at the big dogs. Barking at this huge Great Dane, and then, you know, people are talking to the dog. They won't pet it because they don't get it. The dog's sitting there with no leash, okay, and not moving. That she was in there, they filmed it, and obviously sped up the film, but she was in there for 20 minutes, and the dog never moved. So it's just, and then she walks out, gives the command, and the dog's right by her side. It's just the most phenomenal thing. You know, when I talk about this, and why am I promoting this business? I mean, I'm not on commission. I don't sell his dogs. I'm just talking about this because I've told you many times, which I'm going to talk about in a couple of minutes, is about, you know, guns and handguns and using a weapon and how you're guilty until proven innocent. So, I mean, if you had a dog that could really do something and to tear somebody breaking into your house or somebody attacking you, I mean, that would be the first great, great, great line of defense before having to use a weapon, which, again, you're guilty until proven innocent with that. So I just wanted to talk about that. I've only got about 10 minutes left, so I want to be able to do another handgun technique, and I brought a laser gun this time so you could actually see. It's hard to tell that he either shot me or missed me until you see the dot. The sound doesn't really work, and obviously the wooden gun didn't. You know, first I want to commend this guy. There's a multimillionaire that every year he gives out $100,000 away anonymously. He gives it to different people, and he gives it to people to give to other people. And this year, he gives $100 until $100,000 is done. He's a multimillionaire. He does this anonymously. What a wonderful man. But this year, he gave it to a police department. And the police department would actually try to pick out cars that were not looking so good, or people they thought really needed it. And he spread that out to the whole police department. And the police departments, had the lights going, pull somebody over, said you were targeted, and people, you saw all these different reactions. And then they would hand him a $100 bill, and people were hugging him, people were crying. I mean, it was the greatest thing I've ever seen. And today, with all the negativity with police officers now, you know, I mean, I not only did it give a different perspective for law enforcement, but I'm sure, I'm absolutely sure that the people, the law enforcement people, the police officers, it helped them a lot to be able to do something like that. So it changes a lot of perspective. And again, I'm talking a little fast because I don't have much time. But I want to talk about this new, you know, Connecticut last week recently had to shut down all their schools in Fairfield County, Connecticut. 10,000 kids had to go into lockdown. 10,000 kids. It was unbelievable. There was a threat of an active shooter, and I think there was a bomb threat too. And ABC News showed this one clip, okay, of this cop talking to a mother that wanted to go in and get her kid, and he said, no, you can't do that. And apparently, you know, and then all it showed was him saying, ma'am, if you go in there, if you go into that school, you're going to get shot. Now, I'm not sure if there's any situation that would warrant that statement, but this is the typical media. You can't judge by what you see in the media when it comes to a lot of things, especially when it comes to police officers, because they're very negative towards law enforcement now, as you know. So they show this one clip of him saying that one thing. We have no idea what was said prior to that or what that woman was doing prior to him having to react like that. So I just want to say, you know, when you see these things, when you see the negative things that police officers do, they only show that. They never show what happened prior to that, okay? So that warranted that kind of behavior. I'm not saying all police officers are the greatest things since ice cream, but you know, it's like, you know, Robert De Niro said it best, you know, in his movie, when he did this movie with Al Pacino. He said, you know, some people respect the badge, but everybody respects the gun. And yeah, you know what? It is a position of power, and it is something when you're putting on that badge and that gun, and you're putting on that uniform. It's a thing of pride and power, and there's no doubt about it. And some people do abuse it, but that doesn't start with police officers. This goes all over the world and to countries. So you know, they just should spend more time showing all good things that law enforcement does. And I wanted to say that. So I'm going to do this, Jeff. You want to bring that gun up? I got about 7 minutes. I want to see if that I want to be able to see if that that laser will show up. Hopefully it will. Okay. This is it. This is a laser gun. I don't like pointing anything at anybody, but obviously that's the way this is going to work. So Rick, can you tell me on me especially, Jeff? You want to just point it at me and see if it can be seen? Maybe I'll button this. You can see it. Okay. So what if we stand? Okay. Where is it? There it is. Okay. So I talked about this before. I want to say one other thing. The gun technique isn't going to do a lot right now because I don't have a lot of time, but I am going to show it. I got about 6 minutes. Is that the law enforcement are changing the way they teach people in schools to react. You know, it used to change. They used to say first line of defense, if there's an active shooter in your school, is to get out. And I still agree with that, and they still do that. Now they're saying that the second line of defense is to attack the attacker, okay? And I agree with that, but unfortunately, okay, that doesn't work with little kids. So the only one that would be qualified to be able to do that would be the teacher, all right? And that teacher would need training. And I'm not talking about just martial art training. I'm talking about how the teacher would have to be trained if you're dealing with little kids, okay? And once the attacker comes through the door, what do? Can you slam the door on the guy? Yeah, but you know what? In order to do that and really stun the guy or hurt them or knock them down, you'd have to be incredibly strong. So the teacher would need some sort of weapon. I'm thinking like a stick that could do some damage. And then that teacher would have to know what to hit and how to hit it. So again, you know, it is a good line of defense because somebody comes into a classroom, which is and has a handgun. Well, normally they're not coming down in like this. They're coming in like this, or they're coming in like this. Okay. So yes, I agree that they should. The teacher should be trained to be able to handle that, because if that shooter comes in, someone's going to get shot. And more than one, and that's, you know, historically, that's the way this has happened. Okay, so let me see, I got about 5 minutes, all right? So we're doing this. What the problem with this with martial artists, because I've shot a lot of people that are martial artists, myself holding the handgun, is that good martial artists are trained to move their body first. Now I'm going to telegraph, that's called telegraphing. Okay, so in order to be powerful, you move your body and you follow in with the punch, because this weighs nothing. I've talked about this before. So you hit and the body moves first. Just like a boxer. A boxer doesn't do this. A boxer does this with its body and then follows through with a punch. All right, so if you telegraph with this, it's just the opposite. That's why this takes incredible mental training and incredible speed without telegraphing. Now I'm going to telegraph. Jeff's, when I move Jeff, I want you to shoot me, okay?
Yes, sir.
I moved. You didn't shoot me fast enough. Okay, I'm going to go over here so they can see. Let me see. Shoot me again. I can't see it. Can you see it, Rick?
I can, yeah.
Okay, good. All right, I'm going to telegraph, okay? I'm going to go fast with my hand, but I'm going to do what I do as a martial artist. I'm going to move my body first. You ready? Go. Do it again. Go. I'm getting shot. Am I getting shot, Rick?
You're getting shot.
Okay, now I'm going to move. All right, now hold it to my head. All right, now this is what most people will do, because this takes training. How do you do this and move this away, okay, without moving your body? Now when I move, I want you to shoot. Go ahead, shoot. Okay, I'm going to do here. Okay, you ready? Okay, you ready? You see? I'm done. Now watch. See, I have to focus. You got it on my head? Okay. All right, I got to focus. If I telegraph, he's going to shoot. As soon as I move, he's going to shoot. He didn't even get the trigger off at that time. Try it again. You see, because what I did, all right, let's go to the front, right here. You ready? I'm going to shoot me. Did you get me?
Nope.
You didn't? I telegraphed. You got to shoot quicker, Jeff.
Yes, sir.
Ready? Now watch. See, I'm totally relaxed. That's how you get out of the way of the gun. My body's not moving, just my arm. Go ahead, shoot. You ready? Get ready, I'm going to move. I even told him I'm going to move. Okay, because the brain has a delay. But I'm not telegraphing. I'm not telegraphing. I love these videos when I see these guys on Facebook say, I got the fastest gun technique on the planet. I don't know what that is. 45 years. I'm not making fun, but maybe a little bit. What is the fastest gun technique on the planet? I don't know what that is. Okay? The fastest gun technique on the planet is to get out of the way of that bullet, out of that little hole, like he just shot me again. Okay, you ready? All right, shoot. You ready? Go. You say go. You ready? Boom. I'm going to tell you this time when I'm going to shoot. I'm going to move. I'm going to move. Jeff, I'm going to move. Okay? The thing is, I'm totally relaxed. I am quick. I've been doing this for a long period of time. I'm totally relaxed. Okay? But that's how you do it. And then I've told you how to get rid of the gun. Once you got your hand on that gun, you come in with both hands. Your body has to come in totally. Doesn't make any difference whether it's here, one, two, I'm going to come in with my body weight. I'm not going to stand out here. Jeff's a strong guy, and he could withstand that. And remember, there might be people over here. So you got to know where, because that gun's going to go off because his finger's in the trigger. So next week, we're going to do some more different self-defense techniques. Okay, I'm done with the gun stuff unless there's another shooting and I need to talk about it. Okay, thank you for joining us. I'm Steve Damasco, the Grandmaster. Sensei Jeff Scrocky, thank you very much.